Sam,
thank you.
I just realized that nobody's life is private anymore.
You
can pull out pictures from the past 10 years on Facebook and
like there were too many airline photographs over there, but pictures tagged of you, that's what makes a difference. People don't see that, how many pictures are tagged of you. So yeah. Then you pull out all those photographs. Okay, welcome to Jam with Sam. This is the 21st episode of Indian Networker. You began how many years back? I pulled out your LinkedIn profile, so I got a lot of, where all you were, so I could get all the logos and all. So tell us, how did you start?
Well, I started off with in sales with Cadbury's Dollops ice cream. I think those who are born in the 70s or early 80s also would remember Dollops ice cream. I think it was one of the best brands in those days. And unfortunately, we had to sell out to Walls, which came in. Walls picked up Milk Food, and then they picked up Dollops, and then they picked up Quality, and they got a very quick entry into the market. Those 4 years, though, were very interesting and exciting because it was the only country outside in the Cadbury universe where Cadbury's were selling ice creams, and it was a new business for us. We built up the market, we built up the brand, and I think we achieved a lot in 4 years. And those who remember Dollops would remember it as being ice cream of very high quality. Yeah. The ice cream man over here, Mr. Kamat. We were the first to launch blackcurrant ice cream in the country, apart from some of the other flavors. We had a whole range of chocolate flavors, etc. So, very good stint over there. After which, I joined Levers for a year. In those days, the company was called Brookbond Lipton.
Okay.
Which was both the tea brands, and that company had picked up Dollops, so we were sort of acquired along with the rest of the the people, the factories and all that. That was a reasonably good experience. Levers is very different from Cadbury's in terms of culture. Mm. It's very stiff upper lip.
Okay.
I remember there that I was not entitled to a tea bag because my grade didn't allow it, and I could only get bana hua chai. So I mean, that really freaked me out because in Cadbury's, we had a very open and different culture. So we had a very hierarchical thing. When people left the company, you would, maybe it's changed now, I don't know, but I'm just telling you what I experienced. Tea bags was one of them. And then when someone leaves the company, when there's a farewell party, only people over a certain grade are invited and all that. So a little too British for my liking, I guess. After which I joined Kodak. Kodak was, I think, to date, the most wonderful company I worked for. American company, very good culture, very human. I learned a lot. I traveled the world in Kodak, and I think it was in terms of achievements, probably the best, the best learnings also in Kodak. Then from Kodak, I joined.
So you left Kodak before it had that downfall, or?
Yeah, I left Kodak in 2002, and I think the downfall had started not only for Kodak but for the whole photo category, and I think it was largely the fault of Kodak and the fault of companies like Kodak and Fuji, who were in the imaging space with traditional silver halide, which is your films and cameras and photo paper. The writing was on the wall as far as that was concerned, and I know in internal meetings we had that people were saying that it'll take 5 years or 6 years for this the digital revolution to come, and till then we'll pull on and we'll make money. Just to give you an example, a film roll, those of you who've used film rolls, of course, the film role would sell at a worldwide selling price of about $2.50. We had a worldwide average selling price of $2.50 for a 36 exposure film role. That film was manufactured, the manufacturing cost for Kodak was 38 cents. Shit. So we were making more than $2 per film. And we used to sell, in India, we used to sell about 40 million films. So you can imagine how much money we made. And that was the main thing which stopped the company from actually killing that or slowly killing it and getting into digital. Kodak had invented a digital camera in 1994. I have seen it in Rochester. But we did not launch it because the marketing guys thought if you launch this product, it will kill the rest of the company. And which it ultimately did. Kodak did launch a digital camera, but it was too late. Which was a sad story. It was a wonderful company. When I left, I think it was about $14 billion. Today, Kodak has been fragmented and sold off in various bits and pieces. Whatever's left of it is probably less than $2 billion. So it's about 10% of what it was 10 years ago or 15 years ago. So it's very unfortunate. And I think what's happening now, if you look at the same, the whole imaging space, what cameras will be left in the years to come are your SLR cameras, because even your compact cameras are giving way to cameras in phones. Nobody carries a compact camera anymore because your phone cameras have become so good, your flash is so good, everything is so good. You don't really need that product. So, you know, unfortunately, companies like Canon and Nikon who are in the compact camera business, they'll only be left with their mainstream
product. They already stopped and, you know, they're coming out like niche products, like, you know, Super Zoom and all that stuff and all. But if you see, it's like, it's a dying business.
Absolutely. So, it's unfortunate, but I guess that's the rule of business. If you don't innovate, and you don't change with the times, then you die. I mean, it's very clear.
Just yesterday, somebody had called me up for a Rotary Club meeting. So, and I mentioned we have a speaker, Sanjay Mehta. We were both together in Kodak.
Who's that? Adesh.
He called. He called you over there. So, I mean, see the connection made over there. He saw we have mutual small friends world on Facebook over there. Okay. After that.
Well, after that was Big Bad Reliance. I don't know, I could write a book on Reliance. I only spent 2 years there, but I mean, I have never seen a place which was so so unprofessional, so unethical. Sorry to say, but for those who admire that company, you don't know anything, because when you work from inside, you know how rotten it is. And the thing I tell people when they ask me about Reliance is that it has so much of potential. Reliance could have been a world famous brand, but it is not. And I think the only thing which prevents it is the culture. So those 2 years were just spent. I mean, I never felt for a single day that I belonged part of that company. And I just took out time, and then I didn't want it to look bad on my CV that, you know, you've left in a quick, you know, just 1 year or whatever. In 2 months, I knew I wasn't fitting in that place, and I said, it's time to go. But I pulled on for 2 years. And at the end of it, Hital Meswani, who's Mukesh's cousin, he called me twice and two occasions for 2 hours. He grilled me, chewed my brains, and tried to, you know, get me to stay there with all sorts of incentives. He'll put you anywhere in Reliance. You name the company, petroleum, retail, blah, blah. You know, we'll double your salary. What are they giving you? The new place you're going, etc. I told him, Hital bhai, what you're offering me is good, but A, I will not do it because I've already signed up with the new place. And two is, what Reliance is, it's not up to you to change. I mean, it'll require an earthquake to change Reliance. I mean, even Mukesh Ambani had said that Reliance is like an octopus. I heard him saying it once. He said it because he was in a very foul mood, and he said, you know, one thing we have not done in Reliance is that it's an octopus and one arm doesn't know what the other is doing, which is a fact. I mean, when I was there, we were doing a certain job, and suddenly you would realize there's another set of people somewhere else doing the same work. I mean, what sense does that make? It's incredible, but that's how it was.
Actually, all the decisions are taken by the top, and most of the people don't know what's going on only, but they're a decision-making power, and they have no clue what's going on over there.
See, Reliance is run by a coterie. It's like, there's this famous word started when Rajiv Gandhi was the prime minister. So there is a coterie of mainly people who are Mukesh's college buddies and school buddies.
Okay.
And they run the company. So anyone who comes from outside, anyone who has promise, there's a famous story which used to do the rounds in Reliance in those days, which probably some people have heard it now, is that Mukesh Ambani goes on a street and he looks at various houses, Indian Oil. This is about an oil company thing, Indian Oil, Bharat Petroleum, and in each place there's, you know, there are tigers there. So he tells the tiger, come, I'll give you a Jersey cow. what is Indian Oil giving you? They're giving you a goat for lunch. I'll give you a cow. So come to Reliance. So the guy joins Reliance. So the first time he doesn't get a cow, he gets an Indian cow. He's saying, what is this? I was promised a Jersey cow. So a few days the Indian cow comes, then the cow becomes smaller and smaller, then one day there's a goat. And as this whole process comes, one day his teeth are removed, the claws are removed. At the end of it, you only have a tiger with skin and it can't do anything because the claws and the teeth are gone. So that is what happens in Reliance. I mean, my own example, in Kodak, I had a marketing budget of $15 million. Which I could not spend at will, but we had a budget and we said, okay, in 1 year, these are the activities you could, and I could sign off on whatever. I joined Reliance and I realized I cannot even sign a voucher of 20 rupees.
Shit.
So that's, you know, that's how it is. And I'm sure they know it, but for whatever reason, they don't want to change. And unfortunately, for them, it's something which will impede. It's a huge company, of course, but I don't think it's really going to become a global brand or a company which people would like to work for. The only thing that Reliance gives you is money. That's it. That's a trap. So they'll give you a lot of money. Once you go there, you'll realize that you're out of the market. But you want to leave, you can't leave because they've given you money so much that nobody else will give you that money. So it's a double-edged sword. So it's your choice. Anyone who's a caveat emptor, as far as Reliance is concerned.
Okay, after the bad world of Reliance.
After Reliance, I joined UTV, which was a complete shift because so far I was always in retail. So I joined UTV as vice president for motion pictures. And that was, I think, one of the best experiences from the learning point of view. Because for those of you who are famous, familiar with how Bollywood works, or at least a little familiar with how Bollywood works, you know, you have all these figures floating around. By Bajrangi Bhaijaan did 300 crores, this movie did so much crores. A lot of it is bullshit. Because there is no system to collate the figures from all the theaters. It is all hearsay. When I was in UTV, I used to get calls from trade magazines and ask me, kitna hua? So my guys used to ask me, what should I say? So I said, do some calculation and say what you want. But don't say it in such a way that it's, you know, it's exaggerated. So that's how it is. There is no system in Bollywood. They still work with a film territory, which was the map of India in the 1950s. There are things called East Punjab, Nizam territory, which is part of Hyderabad, Andhra ceded, CPCI, which is Central Provinces and Central India, which is Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh and all that. So that industry is still stuck in a time warp. One of the other things I learned is that how do you cheat cinemas in, you know, not in Bombay, but smaller cities, how do you cheat? You run shows which are not recorded. It's 9 o'clock in the morning, suddenly there's a show. It's not advertised, but the theater is full. There are extra, these, you know, those Neil Kamal plastic chairs, those are kept. So you get those guys inside. You make us, there's a separate register for the entertainment tax, official and unofficial. So all this chori happens, you know, so sab dekh liya humne. So that was a very interesting experience, learning how Bollywood operates. We set up a completely parallel distribution network, which was not part of the whole Bollywood system. And people told us that you will never not succeed, you will not succeed. And I'm proud to say that I set up that network, which today has earned Mr. Ronnie Screwvala crores of rupees.
So then UTV got bought by Disney, no?
UTV got bought by Disney. I think one of the biggest things, two things went in the favor was, one was the distribution network. And the second one was the fact that he had, I think Ronnie was very good in, you know, creativity, striking alliances with the right people to produce movies, you know, joint ventures and all that. So Swadesh was one of his first, which I distributed actually. That was the first one I did in 2004, I remember. It didn't make money, but it was a good experience to do that. And then I think the last movie I released was Rang De Basanti, which was in 2006. So I left there and, yeah, dealing with Ronnie was another interesting aspect because he was an entrepreneur and he was, again, his public persona is very different from him in the office. I mean, I'm basically a very cool person and he used to throw these temper tantrums. So I used to sit in his room and he was into one of these tantrums. I used to just sit like this. And he would stand up and bang the table and do all that. And I would just, I'll say, Ronnie, have you finished? I don't know what I have to do to get through to you. But I mean, he was just ballistic at times. And After a point, he would stop doing that because he knew it wouldn't affect me. He would try to, you know, browbeat me and shout and scream and all that. But again, the whole cultural aspect, I think, in my experiences with the foreign companies, the cultural aspect was a very important thing, which I did not see in Indian companies. And I think that's a great learning which Indian companies should adopt from multinationals. I mean, not all multinationals are great, but a lot of them are. And I think that's one of the key learnings which Indian companies should have from foreign companies.
Okay.
Yeah.
So after you did with Screwvala, then
after and Screwvala did live up to his name with many people. So, luckily, he didn't succeed with me, but he's known to be quite ruthless. Anyway, so after that, I did a joint venture with this company called Shopworks, which is a British company. I went back to my core competency in retail and started doing retail consultancy, which was retail research, store design, that kind of stuff. And that company is still active. I'm still doing some work in it. Started off in 2006. Now it's about 9 years.
Okay.
So yeah, we've done fair amount of work in India and Sri Lanka for a good amount of clients as well. So that was good.
So
that was good.
But you're still with Shopworks?
Yeah.
You're still with them?
Still with them. We still do a lot of work. Right now also we've got a couple of clients we're working for. So that's going on. But of course it's a bit on the back burner because Sparcelon has taken priority.
So that's my next question. Tell us something about Sparcelon.
Well, Sparcelon is not a global brand, it's a Pan-Asian brand, as you saw from Sampath's video. It is called Luxury Ayurveda. Now, Luxury Ayurveda is, our cosmetics are made only using natural products. We don't use alcohol, we don't use any products of animal origin, we don't use any chemicals. The brand started off in Sri Lanka about 5 years back and has already grown to about 30 stores in 10 countries. In India, we have 3 stores, 2 in Bombay, 1 in Goa. We are opening probably another 6 or 7 in the next 10 months. Already in talks with various people, so that will happen. And contrary to popular perception, I'm known as Spa Sanjeev, but we do not have a spa. We only sell products. We have 150 products, hair care, hand care, body care, face care, etc., etc. Aromatherapy products, but we do not have a spa. The spa will come soon, and I will inform you. You'll be the first to know when it starts.
So all the tinners will get, you know, free spa sessions over there.
No, in fact it's a good thing to get people to try your product.
Mm.
Because we have spas in Sri Lanka and one of the biggest sales boosters is the spa itself. So with the spa we also have the store. We don't have a spa without the store. So whenever we have the spa, the store is already always part of it. When a customer is getting a ritual, we don't call them treatments because they are different from the traditional Thai massages and all that. We use our products only. So in a spa salon foot massage, we will actually use 4 or 5 different products. A foot soak, a foot scrub, a balm, a foot lotion. Whereas in a Aroma Thai or Sukhothai, you'll just use, they'll do the massage, but they'll use only one oil or something and that's over. Right? When we are using the product, the staff tell them that, you know, tell the customers that this is what we are using. This is what it does. This is how it helps. So that's a great sales booster, and that's what we're going to do here. So when we have exhibitions and all that, we are also going to get the treatments over and all. We'll do all that.
How is the online market working for you? Things like Flipkart and all that.
The online market is about 10% of my sales today.
Okay.
I was just telling Raj that Flipkart is our biggest vehicle right now, and it's way ahead of anyone else. Flipkart accounts for about 67 or 68% of my online sales.
Okay.
We get 5, 6, 10 orders every day from Flipkart. And in some, when the gifting season, festival season, it goes up to even 15 or 20 a day. Amazon has been pathetic. We get 1 or 2 orders a week. My own website, we get good orders, but if I look at Flipkart, and Flipkart is about 68%, mine is around 20% odd. That's 88, and another 12% comes from Amazon, Snapdeal, Lovely Lifestyle, and one more website, I can't remember the name now, which are the small. So Amazon is not even 12%, it's part of that 12%, which is unfortunate. I don't know why it's not working, but Amazon is not, but Flipkart is clearly working, and it's growing, every month it grows.
I think the reason Amazon doesn't work is they keep on showing aur dikhao, the customer keeps getting more and more confused, kya khareedo usme, you know, like.
Yeah, I go to the Amazon site once in a while, but for some reason it doesn't motivate me to buy.
It's the interface sucks.
Yeah.
Like when you go to Flipkart, even the you feel like, you know, they made the interface so well over there. You feel very comfortable dealing, and that Twitter handle is very, you know, like if there's a problem, they get back to you. The delivery mechanism is very good. Sometimes people do have bad experiences, but I mean, I'm pretty happy with Flipkart.
No, Flipkart has a very good system because, of course, it took us about 2 months to get onto Flipkart. They've got millions of paperwork to be done and all that uploading. They've got some template, and it was a big headache. We had to reshoot our whole range to suit their template and all that. Anyway, all that is done. But after that, it's been smooth sailing. We get our money quickly. The orders come. There's a proper system. You know, the dashboard. Yeah. Uh-huh. All that is really easy to put in prices. When you do a sale, you can do all the sale price and upload, remove. All that is very easy. They come once a day, every evening, and pick up the product. Those boxes are there, which you can buy, you know, from them only. They sell their own boxes to you. I'm sure they make money on that as well. You know, the one in which you put the product. So we buy those boxes, put the invoice, and that's it. It's a very well-oiled system which works very efficiently.
Correct. So what do you think of the future of retail? You know, like Landmark just closed down in Infinity Mall. So for many days, you know, we are doing stock checking. I think 15, 20 days, nobody does stock checking. And it's quite a expensive property over there. And I saw slowly their CDs disappeared, DVDs disappeared, everything started disappearing. And one day the store has disappeared. And now my son told me Pantaloons has come over there. So what is it? I mean, those things are slowly, you know, going out of style. But do you think retail will still survive?
I think anything which has content which can be digitized does not really have much of a future.
Mm.
So books, movies, music, you've seen Crossword Go, Landmark. I mean, not Go, Crossword is still around, but I'm sure they're selling more toys than,
correct.
You know, and stuff. Archie's also, you know, that whole greeting cards, it's all gone. So Archie's has become from a greeting card store to a gift store. And, you know, mugs and plates and all that.
Correct.
But things like what we are selling.
Experience, basically.
Yeah. Not only the experience, the product itself. I mean, you cannot download a face cream, right? You can't do that. So you have to go. I mean, you can order it online, but you cannot download a face cream. nor can you download a pair of ladies' stilettos. Nor can you download jewelry, clothes. So all these products of these categories will, I think, in a way, be impacted by the online thing. But then, at the end of the day, we still want to go out. We still want to go to malls. We still want to touch and feel the product. Yeah. We still want to have that movies and, movies, entertainment, dining experience in a mall. Again, not all malls. And that market is also limited. I was just, again, discussing that there are only a couple of malls in Bombay which are working. There's Infinity 2, there's Oberoi. Inorbit is also going down a bit. You've got Palladium, and you've got R City, which is also watered down, and you've got Viviana. So you've got like six malls in a city of 18 million which are working. The rest are all finished. So, you know, as a retailer, I have to choose my mall very carefully. We are in R City, but that store is not doing well. I'm not at all happy with it. My Bandra store is doing 3 times business as R City store.
It could be
being on a high street.
So you think if you had started in Palladium, would have been better?
Palladium would have probably been better. We did go to them, but they told us that we've got 6 cosmetic brands already, so we don't want a 7th one. And they said we are thinking of actually closing down 1 or 2. So they said they have to, because in a mall like Palladium, which is a very upmarket mall, they have to plan and, you know, look at which brands are there, what's going, what's coming. So I understand as a retail guy, I understand their. I mean, I would like to be there, but then I have to wait till they give me a space.
So St. Regis has taken it over now. The whole management of Palladium is gone. So St. Regis has taken it over.
Regis, yes.
So they have taken over. Even the mall, they have taken over. So Ashwin Kukreja was telling about. So they have taken over. So they are looking, maybe able to try.
Maybe I need to get back in touch.
Over there. So you think retail will still stay in that?
Like I said, certain product categories will definitely stay. People do want to go out, touch and feel product, experience it. For our product, again, when I think long term for me, for Spa Salon, is the way to go for us is to have a spa, a foot spa, not a complete spa, foot spa and a product store together, which we call a boutique, where the customer can experience the same products with our own treatments. And that is something which will be more profitable than a product store alone. It will get traffic in. And for us, it's the experience when any of you come to our stores, the fragrance which we put in, we play our own music, the whole Spa Salon experience is something completely different, which is also there to a point in Forest Essential. It's also a very good brand, but we are better.
Okay. So how was the shift from being an employee all these years to become an entrepreneur?
Well, I think the biggest shift is that you don't get your guaranteed salary at the end of the month. And I think that's what prevents a lot of people from taking the plunge. And I have so many colleagues from, you know, Kodak and Reliance and all who all keep on, whenever we meet, they keep on threatening to leave their jobs and, you know, start some entrepreneurship, some venture. Then they chew my brains and say, what should we do? And then we discuss it for hours till the cows come home and all that. But they're still there. Most of them are still there. Of course, some of them have become a little bold and taken the plunge. But a lot of them have not. And I think that's it's that comfort level, that security of the job, that, you know, you'll get your salary at the end of the month. Nothing will happen to you. When you're an entrepreneur, you have to manage your own salary or your director's fees or whatever. In some months, you don't get it. In some months, you get a lot more. In some months, you don't get anything at all. I think it's... But I would not, after being an entrepreneur and a businessman for the past 9 years, no way I would go back to corporate life and become a corporate slave. No way.
Good.
In spite of all this, no way.
So what's your favorite platform? Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, or LinkedIn?
Facebook for sure.
Yeah.
Because I'm very verbose when I write.
Yeah, I know.
You know. So I am not on Twitter because I cannot write anything in those 142 characters. I just can't. It's not possible. I mean, how can you write an opinion in and then truncate the words into some silly thing? So I'm there on Twitter, but I don't use it. It's there, but somewhere around.
You've been tagged. Spa Salon also has been tagged in there.
Yeah, we're there. Spa Salon is on Twitter. Thankfully, I don't have to do it. The agency does it for me. They tweet and whatever. Instagram is okay. It's nice once in a while. But I think Facebook is the best platform because it's very multifunctional. There are pictures, there's video, there's ravings and rantings and all that. So I think Facebook is good, and I think Facebook is something which will continue for quite a while. At least it's my personal favorite.
Something about your family?
Well, wife is a banker. She's been with, again, she's the one who, another one who won't leave her job. SBI, she works with SBI government company. And she's very happy there. Again, she's been threatening to leave for a very long time. I want to leave, I'm fed up, I don't like this, I don't like that, blah, blah. But at the end of the day, the salary comes and she's happy. So, stay there. She's been wanting to join Spa Salon. And I'm actually dissuading her. She's not here today. I wish she had come. But she goes for dance class. She loves to dance. I hate dancing and I can't stand loud music, but she's the opposite. So, you know, Otis Club on Saturdays where there's music at 200 decibels. She'll be there and I'll be sitting outside waiting for her to finish and I'll take them home after that. So,
kids?
Yeah. Kids, two kids. Sonakshi is, she's going to be 15. Laisha is going to be 10. Both are in Petit. One is in the 9th, one is in the 5th. Again, with kids these days, you know, I'm tearing my hair almost on a daily basis. I don't know if I'm the only one, but when I'm talking to parents of kids at this age, it's pretty much the same. That's it. All the time, it's bloody WhatsApp. It's, what is that? Snapchat. What is Snapchat? I mean, ridiculous. I mean, it's crazy. When we were kids, there was no Google.
There were no cell phones.
And even the bloody MTNL phone wouldn't, not MTNL, what was it called? Bombay telephones in those days. Those big black fat things, they would never work anyway. But it was more fun. We would go out on our bicycles. I would go to the club and swim, play cricket. Here, kids are not, I mean, I've bought cycles for them every 3 years. They'll use it when it's new. Then the cycles will get rusty and then it's given away to the Bangarwala for 200 rupees each when we've paid 4,000 rupees for those cycles. I mean, it's incredible, but that's how it is. And then my daughter tells me I can't study without music.
Yeah, my son also.
I mean, how can you study with music? I mean, you're reading something, you're doing a math sum, you're studying your bio.
Maybe
at least the younger one is a little, she hasn't reached that stage yet, and she hasn't got a phone, thank God. She's asking for it when she's 10. I'm just dreading the day she...
They're called as screenagers. They only watching the screen over
absolutely.
There.
Absolutely. I mean, it's
don't worry, all of us have gone through that, yeah. Okay, whom do you admire as an entrepreneur?
Whom do I admire as an entrepreneur? You know, there's this guy called Mahesh Murthy.
Yeah. He's going to be on the show in the next 1 or 2 months.
Okay. I know him well, so if he's not...
Anshu Gupta, who had...
Anshu's husband. So Mahesh, I think, is quite a guy as far as this is concerned. He was in the advertising agency world, and then he left. And you know, the good thing about him is, and I'm jealous because I see his Facebook, and he's hardly in town. One day he's in Machu Picchu in Peru. A few days later he's in San Francisco. After that he's in Lapland with Eskimos and polar bears. After that he's in bloody China, on the Great Wall of China. I mean, he's just traveling the world. Kaam kabhi karta hai pata nahi, but obviously he's got money to go, na?
Yeah, so he was the...
So
he has his company Seed Fund.
I know.
And he had Red Bus. So he sold Red Bus and he made a lot of money.
So Red Bus has given him a plane ticket. Yeah. So he's going all over the place.
Okay, so coming to Quick Gun Sam, one witty answer.
One witty answer to what?
To what? I'm going to ask you that.
Okay.
Achhe Din.
Achhe Din. Haven't seen it so far.
Okay. Beef.
I love it.
Alcohol.
Sometimes, very rarely. But Malibu.
Malibu.
I love Malibu, yes.
India.
I think a country which has enormous potential, but we have not even reached 10% of it.
Sri Lanka.
It's our own fault.
Sri Lanka.
Sri Lanka is again hamstrung by politicians, but a country which has really reached a good level. If you go there, you'll know how different it is from us. They're much more advanced. They're much more professional than us. It's a small country, but it's going places. And I think if you look at just the tourist arrivals between India and Sri Lanka, if you divide the tourist arrivals by the population, Sri Lanka's percentage will be much more than ours. Not that it's a good measure to use, but it is just an indication.
Rahul Gandhi. Tough questions, you know. Like.
I hope Mr. Modi does something in the next 5 years, otherwise you'll have him back.
Okay. Point taken. Okay, if given a chance to relocate, you know, with all the bans happening all over the place, you know, today I hope they are not banning alcohol, so, you know, so, which is fast becoming a possibility, which is the country you'd like to go?
Country?
Yeah.
Two countries, actually, which have always been my favorite. One, of course, is Sri Lanka, and second would be London, the UK.
London. Okay.
Yeah.
What's the reason for your passion in airlines? Like 50% of the photographs had only photographs of airlines. So you can connect with my younger son because he'll see the plane. This is a Boeing, this is, okay, fine. So what's the passion behind this airlines?
Well, I think it started when I was a kid, 10 years old or something. We had gone to the UK, my first foreign trip. And when we reached Heathrow Airport, I was like, I just fell in love with the aircraft because here you wouldn't see anything. Yeah. Air India and Indian Airlines and that's it. It just happened, and after that I've just been very passionate about aviation. I can identify an aircraft from its sound most of the time. Seeing it is very easy. You see an aircraft even from, if you see the belly, I mean, if I see the, I can make out what it is. Military aircraft, civil, anything. Airlines, if you quiz me, you know, you have these online quizzes, yeah, yeah. Airline logos, I'll probably get 98% or more. And yeah, that modeling, aero modeling, collecting. I have a collection, again, something which has changed in the digital space. I used to get these postcards,
yeah.
Scenery postcards, picture postcards. I have got 10,000 postcards only of aircraft.
Whoa.
And somebody had offered me 25,000 Deutschmarks 10 years ago for that collection. I don't know what it's worth today. It's obviously in lakhs. So it's something like Euro a family heirloom for me.
Euro price also has gone.
Yeah, yeah. I'm never selling. But yeah, that's it's a passion. So I also am very particular about which aircraft I fly on, which seat I choose. I'm very fussy with all these things because I know. So discussing so captain
then,
about it.
Then you have the theory of what happened to the Malaysian Airlines flight which disappeared.
Now that's a mystery. My theory is that he was. Let's discuss this later. He was flying to. I think that pilot was very smart. First of all, he was the guy. I think it's clearly a pilot. It's a case of pilot suicide or pilot terrorism or whatever you want to call it. He did various things which enabled the aircraft to sort of sneak away. My sense is he was going to Diego Garcia because he had that much fuel to reach there, because he was actually supposed to go to Beijing. It's about 7 hours from Kuala Lumpur, or 5-6 hours. Diego Garcia is 1,000 kilometers from Colombo, and he could have easily reached. And my sense is he went there and he was shot down by the United States, by the guys there, because he wanted to crash into the base. They obviously tried to contact him, which failed because he had switched off all his communication. They shot it down, and then whenever people started looking, they were looking in the wrong place. So that's what I think. I think maybe 20 years later, it will be declassified or something.
Fantastic. A word of advice to all the young entrepreneurs over here.
Well, I would say go for it. If you're in a job, and if you have, of course, you have to have capital. You have to have a godfather or a father or an uncle or somebody to sort of back you up. I had capital. My family had a support and all that. But yeah, you need that. You can't just leave your job and say, I'm going to start a business tomorrow without capital. You need capital. How much you need depends on what you're doing. But do your own thing anytime, always, always.
Fantastic, Sanjeev.
Thank you. So much.
The mug. Yes, the mug.
Thank God, I'm not gifting myself a spa salon.
Spa salon. I was going to ask you that. That's for you.
Thank you. I can see the. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Wolverine.